Let's go. Oh, yes, I hear it. Oh man, I made myself dizzy doing that. Dizzy. What little of a brain is in there does not need to get rattled. So, welcome to the show 2.0 and Legendary here with Al Hastic, my host with the most, who is the Cleveland Browns in Legendary. The Jags, Ryan, and we have got a show for you today. We've moved to the Legendary League. So basically, you know, what we want to do today is kind of give you a, you know, almost a preview. I mean, we're coming in here. It's you know, week number six. We've gone through 5 weeks. You know, we want to give you guys a little snippet of kind of what we do. I know some of you have seen us in the Pro Bowl League, but some of you may have not seen us. So we kind of want to give you a snippet. And our third host, Stefania Bell, a.k.a. Josh, a.k.a. Kansas City in this league.
Yes.
Not with us. He had prior things. So we're going to, you know, Stefania Bell, usually runs through the injury report for the week. So we're going to do his slides for him. You know, obviously Al and I are not trainers or doctors or, you know, we don't do too well with that kind of stuff. So it's a lot of science and, you know, that sort of thing, a lot of names in Latin and, you know, whatever. So he's going to do that for us. And then we're going to break down some games. And then kind of give a, you know, a quarter, you know, we're 5 weeks into the season, kind of a review of of where we're at to this point. And then, you know, we're going to pick some games and then we're going to go, you know, to our kind of normal weekly review of all the games. So where we're going to break down all the games, tell you who did well, you know, talk about weekly injuries, do our picks and then there. So this is kind of a snippet. We're not going to do a full review of the games. It's just kind of a, you know, a few games we picked and gonna do a quarterly review. So Al, you want to go ahead and hit those slides for me?
Not a problem, definitely will.
Al, you got anything to say too? By the way, I'll just do all the talking, you know, I'm the talker.
Yeah, not a problem. Quickly, I'll say something about changing channels pretty much. Definitely do appreciate everything that commissioner over there at Pro Bowl allowed us to do while we were stepping in for him, pretty much, it seemed like. They're putting out a better show every day. so gotta give them a little bit of props on that. They did the call
better
us,
show, not better than this show.
No, better show from the first show. So they're getting better. I'm not saying they're better than us. Their shows are getting better. No,
they're not better than us.
No. But they did call us in.
Sorry, Kevin and Sean, I love you, but you're not better than us.
Yeah,
but, I can't even hear this. So sorry, Kevin.
But definitely do appreciate they asked us to come over at the end of the year because we did a year in review. Because we did a prediction show, but yeah, something that we can work around and see what we can do. But like I said, I definitely appreciate the time that we were over there. It was a learning experience for the both of us and even with Stefania, Josh. So I mean, let's
run it out,
keep on going. So I will share the screen. Go like that. All right. You see it?
So, yeah, like we said, 2.0 with Al, Ryan, and Josh is in here. He'll be with us breaking it down weekly, a super valuable part of our show. So I'm going to act like Josh, right, and try to do this thing. But, you know, we got a nice picture of Saquon's ankle with a frowny face on it. So, you know, this is our week 5 injury report. Josh, thanks for the slides. We're going to try to do our best.
Yep. Appreciate them, Josh.
So, Colts, we're talking about this one today. Max Williams. So, severe knee injury. And I don't even like looking at that. You see that? That doesn't, the picture, I don't like that picture. His knee's all buckled and stuff. Knee injury. Josh was telling us definite ACL and LCL, season ending surgery. So, Sis is going to need a tight end. So she's got Jared Pinkney, and unless he's signing with a team, she has no tight end. Of course, she's in the AFC South, which is my division. So if she wants to compete with the Jags, she's going to need a full roster. And I like this little note that he's left too, Al. He says, see Kansas tight end. So
it's subliminal messages.
Yeah.
Even though he's not here, his presence is felt.
He's looking for a little trade opportunity, I guess. I don't know if this is collusion or what. He put a little message in here. So, Sis hit up Kansas City. He's got tight ends he can trade. Just this picture is making me sick, so go ahead and, you know, change it. So, Juju, you know, apparently hurt his shoulder. They were unable to reduce the dislocation on the sideline, so he had to go to the hospital. So definite ligament damage, labrum damage, not good. Apparently season-ending surgery being most likely. You know, Juju, the Packers spent all that money on him in the offseason. Now the Packers are 0-4. Juju's probably one of his, you know, the weapons he actually does have. 0-5 on that, you know, that Packers team. He does have Amari Cooper, but, you know, Cooper and Michael Carter can't do it alone. So Josh is already saying, look out for that number one pick if you're the Packers. So we'll see how that goes. But losing Juju hurts, but season-ending surgery most likely.
With Juju also, he only signed that one-year deal. With Steelers. So, I mean, with him being hurt, and who knows what's going on with Pittsburgh and Green Bay signing him to that big contract. You don't know what kind of Juju you're going to get now, definitely, while the year's left on that contract.
Well, you never know. He could show up in a better spot, right? I mean, right now he's fighting for targets with Claypool and Johnson, and then they got Harris. So who knows? Yep. Could be better. Quintez Cephas. The Ravens, you know, of course, the Ravens have that loaded, you know, wide receiver core. You know, Quintez Cephas, season-ending surgery, clavicle repair, clavicle fracture, so he's going to need that repaired. You know, like we said, the Ravens are loaded. They've got Claypool and Terry McLaurin and Mooney and Palmer and Elijah Moore. So, you know, hopefully for him, one of those rookies can step up, Elijah Moore or Palmer, to step in Cephas's role. But, you know, he's looking pretty good. He's pretty deep at wide receiver. So, you know, shouldn't be a huge impact for him. You know, of course, any injury, you know, hurts. But he's 5-0. He's pretty loaded at this position. So, at this point, not a huge deal, but obviously something to monitor if someone else was to go down.
Yep. Without a doubt. And they've got a cushion also. They got a 2-game cushion on me in the division. Yeah. So, I mean, they're undefeated right now. So, I mean, they do have a little bit of wiggle room if anything does happen with their team.
Yep. Kenny Galladay, one of my favorites.
This man cannot stay off the injury list wherever he goes.
So Kenny Galladay, we're not sure, knee sprain. They haven't released a whole lot of details. You know, last year it was the hip and then the hamstring. And then even earlier this year, I think it was hamstring. But he is on the Pats. So the Pats have had quite a few injuries. I mean, they've, you know, got Tariq Cohen on IR. Logan Thomas is injured. a few, you know, some of their linebackers, some of their defensive players. So now Golladay joins the equation. So we'll see. He's, you know, the Pats are 4-1 in that division. You know, Mahomes and Cook are kind of carrying him. He does have a pretty good, you know, pretty deep wide receiver core. Jamison Crowder and Hamler and Jacoby Myers. And then some.
Isn't Hamler out?
Hamler is out, yeah. So he's out as well. But Jacoby Myers, Pringle, and Cedric Wilson have kind of stepped up. But, you know, Golladay is, I would say, a huge loss for him. Probably the biggest name of that wide receiver group.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, kind of like the Ravens, he's fairly deep there. And he has, you know, he's got a one-game lead on the Dolphins in that division. So, you know, obviously he's going to need Kenny Golladay. So hopefully it's something he can come back from soon.
Yep.
But, you know, we talked about Golladay. I mean, these injuries for him seem to linger. And, you know, some of the frustrating thing with him is that when they don't rule him out and you're kind of sitting there on the day of and it's like, is he going to play? Is he not going to play? So that's the frustrating thing with Golladay. It's almost like you want him ruled out. You know, it's like whatever.
It's better to have him ruled out.
Yeah, so you know and can make other you know, arrangements. Right. You know, we showed you earlier on the there it is, actual the role right there. But, you know, we showed you on the front page his ankle. So lateral ankle sprain, grade 1+. I'm not sure what the 1+ means, but it does look bad.
It looks horrible.
Yeah, I don't know, like, you know, what it is. But instant swelling, you know, 1 to 3 week injury. You know, and Josh notes here that an IR designation will be the deciding factor of how long he's out. Obviously, if he goes on IR, he needs, you know, he's got to be on there for three weeks instead of one. But he's on the undefeated Raiders squad. That's the only winner is a Raider. And there it is. And a little theme song. Totally forgot about that. Sounds in this league. Great, great. But anyways, he's on a deep, he's got a, you know, a deep, deep backfield. I mean, he's missing Justin Jackson too, but he still has Pollard and Swift, you know, and he's just been rolling through people. So at this point, you know, again, it's like I said earlier, at this point, he's good. He's 5-0, has a, you know, 2-game lead in his division. At this point, he's good, but, you know, you want to not have these stack up. And hopefully for Barkley, I mean, he was playing really well. Hopefully it's a minor thing and not one of those things that kind of lingers all year. Just get in, you know, maybe sit him a week or two and then get him back out there. Tape it up.
And he's been playing pretty well too. That's the thing that kind of stinks. I mean, he's been progressing week by week and all that. I mean, especially with not playing anything during the preseason. And then he was just coming to his own. And then this freak accident just happened and twisted that ankle.
Nuts. So sucks for him, but again, the Raiders can probably maintain for a while. This one kind of hurts them a little bit more. Russell Wilson with the mallet finger injury. So
not Ryan Mallet.
Not Ryan Mallet, the mallet finger.
Oh, okay.
Mallet's finger. I don't know what that even means.
But, is it as useful as Ryan Mallet was?
It probably swole up to as big as Ryan Mallett was. I mean, that was a big dude. So 4 to 6 weeks minimum. I saw he had surgery and then they, you know, had a picture of him in a cast or whatever. It's on his throwing hand. So like Josh said, tough injury for, you know, QB because he's got to grip the ball constantly. You know, and again, this one kind of hurts the Raiders. I mean, he's so talented that I don't think, you know, even without Barkley and Wilson, that, you know, there's many teams in the league that can score with them. But he does have Geno. So at least he has a start, the backup quarterback, which is a nice move by him and smart move there to make sure you grab that. But tough injury here. I mean, there's a nice picture here. I guess this is a mallet finger, the damaged extensor tendon. Looks like that thing is shredded and a dip joint. Ow. The dip joint, I don't know if that's a good-looking dip joint or not, but like Russ needs to cut his fingernail for one. I mean, that's a pretty large fingernail next to the, you know, at the end of the dip joint.
I do have a question for you there, Ryan, and what do you think? With Gino, going in now, do you think you a major reduction in production for both Lockett and DK?
Absolutely. I think, well, and I think probably, you know, again, so for the Raiders, like Geno Wilson is going to use his legs, probably Geno Wilson. I feel like I'm talking about cheesesteaks or something in Philly.
Motel Philly.
Yeah. So Geno's going to, you know, he's going to use his legs a little more than Russell would have. You know, I think Lockett's been thriving, especially over the last, you know, this year for sure, but over the last 2 years on the long ball. Right. So maybe Lockett kind of goes down, tick him a little bit. But I mean, you know, some of these guys, the short dump offs to the running back, maybe tight end see a little uptick. And I think Metcalf may, you know, maybe, you know, you want to get him the ball as much as you can, maybe in like a, you know, a bubble screen, you know, running in the middle, something like that. But, you know, without Wilson, it's that whole offense is taking a downtick. But, you know, in a PPR league, I think maybe, you know, the one that really hurts the most, in my opinion, will be Lockett seeing those deep balls. I don't think he, you know, Wilson's so special with that. So,
okay.
CEH. So, Broncos. It's my boy Shane right here. We were talking about this earlier. Shane, the Broncos in third in their division, 1-4. He's been getting murdered. People have been scoring tons of points on him. He's consistently scored about 200 points, but he's been getting – people are dropping bombs on him. So he's going to need CEH to come back to score some points. I mean, he's got a – it's just a sprain, they said, nothing super serious. But, again, you know, Josh knows 2-4, but whether they put the IR tag on him, I was reading today that they probably will put the IR tag on him and give him the 3 weeks so that he doesn't feel like he has to rush back and he can – you know, kind of take his time and heal there, because, you know, they've got a couple capable runners in Williams and McKinnon on there. So, you know, the Broncos do have McKinnon. So he's got to hope that McKinnon gets the majority of the carries there, the majority of the snaps over Williams, which I think at this point it's kind of, you know, up in the air. I don't know. Daniel Jones. Saints got a concussion. This is one of the, you know, one of the ones that concussions are kind of, you know, you don't really know. You got to evaluate them week to week, see how it goes day to day. So hopefully Jones comes, you know, is able to play this week. Again, the severity is going to get evaluated constantly. So hopefully he's able to play. The Saints, you know, or another team currently undefeated, kind of rolling through some people. They've got Glennon on their roster, but, you know, you don't want to start Glennon if you don't have to. So, yeah, we'll see what happens with him. I'd imagine if it isn't severe, he'd be back this week. If it's more severe, maybe he misses a week. So probably no super long-term things here, Al, just a short stint off for Daniel Jones. And I mean, I think the Saints play Ant this week. No, not Ant. So the Saints play the Panthers, which is actually a pretty big.
Okay.
Panthers are 1-4, but they're, you know, they're a talented team. They've got a lot of talent. So, you know, you got the number one team in the NFC South going against the number four team in the NFC South. So, you know, however that, I mean, that Panthers team can score. So, you know, we'll see what happens there. Daniel Jones playing well, especially with his legs. You know, he along with Saquon have kind of had a, you know, a nice reversal here and a good start to their season. Even though the offense as a whole doesn't look great, you know, for fantasy purposes, they've been doing pretty well.
The one thing that I realized joining these kind of leagues and everything, and with the past leagues that we always had been in, you always wanted the handcuff of the running back. And what I've realized, especially in these big leagues and all that, you want the handcuff of your quarterback. Especially if you got a big name quarterback. I'm not saying Daniel Jones is like Murray or Mahomes or Herbert or something like that. But if you've got a starting quarterback that you know is going to be the starter, you always want to grab that handcuff. So, I mean, that is something to I learned big time on this with me being the Browns and grabbing all the Washington Redskins quarterbacks, because you don't know. I mean, I
football
lost
team, the football team.
Football team, excuse me.
Yes.
But I mean, especially with me losing Fitzpatrick in the beginning of the year, yeah, and now having Heinicke start, I mean,
yeah,
that's a big get for any team that has a starting quarterback, to get that whatchamacallit handcuff for their quarterback.
Yeah, and Blaine, the commissioner, he preaches that, and you saw we made that big trade involving quarterbacks, you know, this week, and each of us had the backup.
Yeah.
So, you know, that was a big part of that deal, was making sure you had the backup to, you know, in case your quarterback went down. So Justin Fields, so a hyperextension here of the knee. He avoided any type of ligament damage. So nothing serious here for him. And I think it's going to be, you know, they're going to monitor swelling, see how he goes, you know, during the week. You know, these guys have the best training staff out. It used to be throw some ice on it, see what happens. I mean, this guy's getting, you know, world-class treatment. So, you know, the Steelers are 0-5, and they have Foles, you know, on the roster, but they don't have Dalton. So if Fields doesn't play, odds are Dalton's going to play. And, you know, the Steelers are going to be digging a bigger hole, because they won't be playing, you know, without a quarter. They'll be playing without a quarterback.
Without a quarterback, yeah. I agree, 100%.
So, the injury bug, the Houston Texans and the Green Bay Packers. The bug's not showing up, Al, did it not?
Yeah, I guess I didn't transpose the bug over. My bad.
Oh, the bug. There's supposed to be a nice little bug there with the Texans logo.
Next week, so there'll be a bug.
Next year, yeah, next week there better be.
Next week will be a bug.
People want to see the bug.
Okay.
Yeah, so this kind of shows, you know, in each division who's been bitten by the injury bug. The Texans and the Packers, again, in red. Red's bad. Red's always bad. So yeah, those are the two worst. You know, we talked about the Broncos with CEH. We just talked about the Ravens with Cephas. You know, this is not the page you want to show up on now. This is not the page. And, you know, the Texans with their big logo in the middle have really been bitten by the injury bug.
Well, you know who's on that list too? I just saw good old Ant's team.
The Jets are there. Yes, Jets, go Ant. So, any more excuses though?
The only way he can win the East is through injury.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I don't know. He's already dug himself a, you know, a two-game hole, so I think he's getting that fishing pole ready already. So this is where we need our own Josh Stefania Bell. So the way I understand this chart is you have each division, each team, and then kind of a division rank, Al, where they stand in the division as far as injuries are concerned. Green is good. Red is bad. I think that's what we
said. Yeah, correct. Correct.
So you see there the NFC South, Carolina is red. They do – he also does a where they stand in the NFL power rank, I think. I don't know. He's going to have to – you know, this is statistics and charts and science. This is specialty.
Yeah, this will be something that Josh will touch on when he should. Yeah. But this is something that he brings to the table, something that we want to show you guys what injuries does to your teams and all that. Yeah. So
I'm too dumb to figure this out.
You're not dumb.
I just see colors. Green is good and red. If you're red, that's not good. So yes, if you see your team here, you see Houston, all the teams we highlighted, Houston, the Jets, Denver, green is good, red is bad.
Plans. All right. We're going to start our
and that's normally done by Josh, but he could not make it today. Yeah. And then, you know, what we normally do is, you know, we at the end of each show, we predict you know, who we think we're going, who is going to win each game. You know, we kind of track that, but then we also do a breakdown of, you know, each week's games. Now, we didn't want to do that today because we didn't do a whole lot of predictions, but we wanted to give you a kind of a sample. So we picked out what, six games. How many games did we review?
We picked six games. I'll say that picked the three guys on this show, picked the commissioner's game, and we picked the closest two games from the weekend. So that's the breakdown of the reason why. But in all actuality, you will get all 16 games next week. We'll break down all 16 games.
Okay. So the first game we have here is the Browns. That's you, Al. So I guess, you know, we picked kind of our games to get an introduction so you can get a name to a face. So the Browns is Al. So Al, go ahead and break down your game here. You got a win. You went 3-2 in the AFC North. The Texans are, you know, 0-5. I think, you know, we talked about earlier about the number one pick. I mean, he's definitely in the conversation with the Packers. So go ahead and let us know who shined this week from these two teams.
For me, Miles Gaskin did. Lucked out, couldn't get any rushing down. But I mean, with them being behind, they had to throw the ball around, and Captain Checkdown Jacoby Brissett throwing it to Gaskin a couple of times and getting two touchdowns, big time helped me out.
A huge game for him. I mean, Gaskin's done terrible all year. I mean, he's had not playing time, so this was a huge game, kind of unexpected, right?
Yep, without a doubt. And then Callaway started off slow in this game and caught that one bomb in the end zone. Excuse me. So that kind of helped out, grabbed some points. And then one of my mainstays that I got on my defense that I like is Buddha. I mean, he had that interception and all that early in the game. So that kind of worked out for me. And this week, to be truthful, this week, going against the Texans, unfortunately, to talk about the Texans like this, I mean, 181 is not going to win you a lot of games, but it'll win you a game against the Texans. And I mean, I'll take a win's a win.
Now, you went to 3-2.
Yep.
Win's a win for you, and a loss is a loss for him.
Yes.
A loss is a win for him.
Now, for him with the Texans, and we were talking about the Seahawks earlier and all that.
A lot of injuries.
Carson being out for quite a bit. Alex Collins stepped in for the past couple of games. Didn't really do much in the Thursday night game, but he's got him. He's got a starter that'll get him some points. And Owa.
Both of those guys. Yeah, both of his other two. I just traded for them.
Yeah, he just got traded. Those two guys got traded to you.
Yeah, so I traded him Justin Simmons, you know, the safety for Denver, the stud safety there for, these two, and the shoe thrower, Marco Wilson. Remember that game in Florida where he threw the LSU kid shoe at the end of the game and they looked up and called Marco Wilson? Yeah. So him, you know, traded for those guys. So they're no longer on his team, but he does solidify, you know, get him a nice safety to kind of build around. It was a stud player for some depth and, you know, good positional need for him. And same for me with linebacker. So
nice. We got the commissioner's game next.
This was a close game, man. This was one that was kind of back and forth. And you know, this was probably one of the games of the week for me. I mean, this is everything you want in a game, Al. High scoring, close, kind of back and forth. Kind of it came down to that, you know, the last game. I mean, Jonathan Taylor, you know, tore it up. So it was kind of like a yo-yo game here.
Oh, you're without a doubt. And looking at this also and talking about Jonathan Taylor winning the Saints the game last night, looking at the cards, Josh Allen being Josh Allen this year and blowing up on that Sunday night game, you just got him, didn't you?
I did. That was another player I just traded, Robert Woods and Baker.
And Jamar Chase is having a pretty solid rookie year. We were all making fun of him because he couldn't see the ball. He only had one catch in the preseason and all that. But, I mean, he's starting to pull away to be the rookie of the year as of right now. Granted, we're only five games in. But if you were to ask me, most likely he'd be your offensive rookie of the year. And Aaron Darnold is Aaron Darnold. I mean, what can you say about the man? I mean, man's a beast in the middle. So, I mean, and then for the Saints, I mean, we talked about Jonathan Taylor blowing up on Monday night. But, I mean, Mike Williams, that man, I don't know why anyone would leave that man wide open every time. He's always open, or the jump ball, nobody can guard him in the corner of that end zone.
I mean, he's like 6'5". I mean, he's a monster.
And he's playing with determination because, like we said, like Juju with a one-year deal, Mike Williams is the opposite of Juju. He's doing it healthy, and he's blown up. And he had that 8 catches for 165. And then we look at DK's, whatchamacallit, stat line. I don't know if you were going to see a lot of that. Two touchdowns in a game for him with Geno as his quarterback, you'll definitely see the 5 for 98. So,
well, they're gonna have to, you know, they're gonna have to throw it to someone, right? I mean, they're gonna have to move the ball. And when you have an injury like that, you got to give it to your best player. And Carson's kind of dinged up, right? You know, we said that earlier, he's got that neck thing. You know, so you're going to have to try to get DK the ball. You may have to get creative and, you know, how are they, but you know, he's going to be the best player on that offense. And you got to get your best player the ball.
Yep.
So Saints win a big one. Saints go to 5-0 in that division. The Cardinals are 3-2. So big high scoring game there. We'll see how both those teams go on the rest of the year. Then you got the Jags, my team, versus the Steelers, who we just talked about being 0-5. You know, the Steelers are another one of those teams that aren't going to score a whole lot of points. You know, we joke about this, Al. When you see your kicker here on the your best player list, you know, it's probably not been a good week for you. You know, Dustin Hopkins played well. I mean, Hunter Henry had a pretty good game at tight end. But, you know, that was pretty much it for the Steelers. Again, they're 0-5, so didn't think they would be able to keep up with me with the kind of the weapons I have. So I went up, you know, 4-1. My one loss to the Giants, Jesse, took me down week one with that high-scoring affair. But, you know, Nick Chubb had a good game. Derwin James had a monster game. I think he had 14 tackles, you know, combined, you know, solo and assist at a halftime. So this is kind of one of the things, you know, Derwin being that Swiss Army knife that you want to see from him. So this is kind of a, you know, a typical, you know, game that you would see from him from his rookie year. You know, he's been hurt. So big game from him. And then Robert Woods, who I just traded to the Cardinals, had a big game. His biggest game of the year, you know, of course, Cooper Kupp was getting all that offense, but, you know, Woods was able to hit the stat line. So Jags go to 4-1, Steelers is again 0-5, a high scoring game from the Jags. Good game here.
All right. We got Josh's team.
So the Pats dropped 258 on him. He scored 153. I know we talked about this, you know, when we talked about moving the show over, he said he was ready to go in rebuild mode. So, you know, 153 points from him, you know, not a great week. He currently is 0-5 in his division as well. So Wentz had a good game, you know, Monday night. So he had a pretty big game. And then AJ Johnson, the linebacker. But other than that, I mean, he just doesn't have a whole lot of weapons. He's got Fant as well, which I think he was hinting at, you know, Laura to have possible have a trade. But he's kind of had a few off games. So we'll see what he does. He just doesn't have the weapons this year, especially to, you know, compete in that division. I was talking about the Broncos. You know, the Broncos are 1-4 in that division, and they're scoring 200. They're averaging over 200 a game. So, you know, scoring 153, especially in this division, is not going to get it. But, you know, the Pats, Patrick Mahomes, I mean, what can you say about him? He's going to score a lot of points every game. This is a huge game for him, actually. This is a lower scoring game for him. So this is kind of a lower game for Pat Mahomes.
That's what I was about to say. Hopefully it's not a trend. But Buffalo did take him to the woodshed and make him look human.
Well, they did have that weather, right? So there was the big weather delay. It was kind of bad weather. Tyreek Hill kind of got dinged up. Edwards-Helaire kind of got dinged up. So he was without a few weapons. I mean, he threw the ball 54 times, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know, this is kind of, again, I mean, this is a floor game for Mahomes, right? It's, you know, 29 is nothing. I mean, if you say, you know, I had Baker before this, and if you would have told me he'd score 29, I'd be ecstatic.
Yeah.
Kind of a floor game for Mahomes, right?
Yep. 100%.
I get really excited about him until he scores 50, 60, you know. but good game from the Pats. The Pats are, again, leading that division at 4-1. So this was a good game, Al. Close game.
This one was definitely a close game. Pretty much we'll just round it 2 points, pretty much 186 to 184.
Yeah, like 2.5.
I mean, Brissett had a typical Brissett game. I mean, 22 points. Hubbard, I mean, I'll say this about Hubbard. They found themselves a good young running back to step in for McCaffrey when he does get hurt. The years before, they had Mike Davis and all that. But, I mean, to have at least a younger running back, I'm not saying Davis is old, but, I mean, to have Hubbard and for the Seahawks to capitalize on not having Panthers not having McCaffrey was a big time. And then his tight end, Donald Parham, or whatever. I mean, enough is just enough. I mean, like I said, 2 points, and then to have two catches for 29 yards, the one touchdown and a 2-point conversion. I mean, you can't go wrong with that. I mean, because the Bucks had, I mean, if you look at the top performers for the Seahawks and you look at the top performers of the Bucks and you just took the scores away, you would have to say the Bucks had to have won because, I mean, Rodgers, Cup, and Rockway, or whatever you want to pronunciate it. I mean, those are big time names and big time scorers in fantasy football. And I mean, Seattle just squeezed out a good win against the Bucks. Rodgers had a typical Rodgers day. Cup did everything but get in the end zone. And like I said, Cup,
this is kind of a down game for Cup this year, right? It was that saw the targets.
And then Ngakoue got the two sacks. So, I mean, like I said, this was a really close game. But this was not my game of the week. It'll be the next game. But what do you think about this one?
Yeah, I mean, the Seahawks, you know, with this win, that's their first win of the year. The Bucks moved to 2-3. So, you know, again, we talked about it. I mean, in this league, I mean, you got to score points and – you know, it's all about the matchup and everything. The Seahawks, you know, averaging, you know, they kind of hit right at their average, right? They're averaging like 180 something points a game. The Bucks were below, you know, they before this game were averaging two something. They're now at 202. Again, looking on paper, you would have thought the Bucks would have won handily. But I mean, that's why you play the game, Al. That's why you play the game.
Oh, without a doubt, without a doubt. And now,
nice win here from the Seahawks to get off the over.
Now, this was the game, my opinion, just looking at because of the score. Yeah, I mean, less than a point.
Yeah.
Less than a point.
And I believe they had some stat corrections too. So it was like, it was kind of a point. Then they had a stat correction that put it to less than a point. So,
So, I mean, it's just crazy to see a game being this close. In fantasy football, you and I have never really seen this before.
No, and when you get,
we've seen it in two leagues right now.
Yeah,
and it's just, you know, crazy.
Well, when you get in a 10-point league, you expect to see this, but or a 10-team league. But when you're in a 32-team and you have all the IDP players, and You know, I think we start 21 guys. You think, all right, well, there's no way with 21 guys that you're going to get, or 21 players that you're going to get a game this close, but it happens. I mean, the last game with 2.5 points. So we had a couple games, you know, less than 3 point margin of victory. It's pretty incredible.
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, look at Washington's team. Robinson, nobody knowing stepping what his job on the team was going to be because of Urban Meyer's and bringing these guys in.
And he's
being James Robinson of last year. And then you got Pittman had a pretty decent Monday night game.
He had that nasty touchdown.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, he did.
And then Diggs for him, 5 tackles, 1 pass defend, defended and an INT. I mean, what else would you need your team to do? And then all of a sudden, if you look at the Lions, you got Roethlisberger being Roethlisberger.
Madison
is the one. That's the one. You don't know what kind of Madison you would get sometimes. And even though that was an ugly game just in general, Lions and Vikings, but Madison showed out and balled out. And
well, again, if you look at it, the one thing, he did have that fumble. Now, without the fumble, the Lions win, right?
Yep.
Well, the same thing with Roethlisberger, right? Without that fumble, the Lions win. So, you know, game of inches, Al. Game of inches.
But, I mean, it's just crazy to see a game, like, less than a point be determined. And like you said, with the stat corrections and all that other stuff, I mean – but this was a really, really good game. And waking up this morning and looking at the scores, and when I had to update all these slides and to be having to put this down, I was like, holy cow, this was awesome.
It was a pretty big game, too, from the standings standpoint as well, because they were both 3-1 before this game. So, you know, Washington goes to 4-1, leading their division. Detroit goes to 3-2. Now, you know, a game behind the 5-0 Vikings. So, you know, 2-3-1 teams kind of duking it out. So, you know, these teams look like they'll be playoff teams based on this. I mean, they've scoring, you know, we talked about, you know, Washington went above there. I mean, Washington's only averaging like 180 points a game, but they're still 4-1 in the division. And it's kind of a weak, you know, a weak division. So, you know, that NFC East is kind of anyone's ball game. So we'll see there. And then the Lions, I mean, they're averaging like 230 points a game. And at 3-2, they got the Bears and the Vikings ahead of them. So they're in a tougher division. So we'll see if the Lions can, you know, get in the playoffs, get above the Bears. We'll see how that division shakes out.
Well, that segues us to our.
The division breakdown. So, you know, we wanted to kind of, you know, with this being, it's almost like a quarterly review here where we're kind of picking up. So, you know, looking at the AFC, the AFC North, you've got the Ravens ahead at 5-0. You know, your Browns, Al, are in second. And then you got the Bengals and the Steelers, you know, with one win, Bengals and the 0-5 Steelers. So, you know, currently, the way this is shaking out, it looks like a two-team race here for the AFC North. Now, those Ravens are scoring 220-something points a game. Now, you're just barely above the 200 mark. So, I think you can be a competitor here, but you may need to make a move for an offensive player or something to score some points. But, you know, this is that young Ravens team, so they're looking good. Hopefully they can overcome some of their injuries and kind of go from there.
Without a doubt, looking at this team, when I first was building this team, I was trying to go from the defense out to the offense. I agree.
Are you wearing a Browns jersey, Al?
Yes, I am. Jordan Cameron.
A Jordan Cameron 84 Browns jersey. I thought that was. Oh, my gosh.
Yes. Wow. Only two people own one besides Jordan Cameron, me and his mom.
You and his mom, maybe his grandma has like a Jordan Cameron jersey, like Afghan or something.
A snuggie.
Yeah.
But yeah, and I mean, Baltimore had a good draft. If I remember, he had a whole bunch of first rounders and all that. So, I mean, he's capitalizing on that without a doubt, 100%. So, and Cincinnati beat me last week, and they're only about a point away from me averaging. So, I mean, for me to have a two-game cushion.
Had you not lost that game to, you know, you not giving him his only game, you'd have been 4-1.
And it was a pretty decent game. It was like less than 10 points, if I remember.
Yeah.
But in actuality, it's nice to be on the winning side. That's for sure.
Yeah. So you're second at the division. So the AFC East, you know, again, we talked about the Pats 4-1 scoring, you know, the pretty high scoring team there. They've got a pretty high scoring division too with the Bills. You know, everyone in this division is scoring, you know, 210 plus, you know, points a game. So Pats are 4-1. The Dolphins, I think they were the champs 2 years ago. First year in this league, still 3-2. So you never want to count, you know, a championship GM out, but currently running in second. And then the Bills and the Jets, both Ants in last in the division, but that's all right.
He's got two wins. He's got wins. Under his belt.
He's on a one game win streak. So we'll see. We'll see if he can make it two this week. But you know, good division there. Pretty balanced division. So we'll see what shakes out in that division over the year.
Without a doubt. I mean, New England averaging that many points to their second place rival of the Dolphins. I mean, just like I said, looking at the other divisions and all that, this has got to probably be the toughest division, at least the closest division amongst themselves. And I'm not saying from top to bottom.
Yeah, it's the tightest. I mean, they're very similar. Yeah. I mean, they're very competitive with each other.
100%.
Yep. AFC South, my division. So currently the Jags 4-1 up top. Again, had that loss opening week to the Giants, who, you know, with Dak Prescott and the ageless wonder, Pernell McPhee, dropped 270 on me. But, you know, scoring a good amount of points, made that big trade. So we'll see how that affects the team. Big game against the second place Colts this weekend. So Sis is coming to Jacksonville. So we'll hope to introduce her to both the Josh Allens, you know, both Josh Allens on the offense and one on the defense. But, you know, she's scoring about 220 points a game. That Tennessee Titans squad, you know, after Indy and Jacksonville, I think for the last at least couple years, it's kind of been a two-team race in that AFC South. It kind of falls off. I mean, the Texans, you know, they're only scoring like 60 points a game, rebuilding. The Titans, you know, they had that big offseason acquisition of Tyreek Hill, but they kind of know, you know, that they're kind of in a rebuilding-ish type mode. So, you know, those Titans are 2-3, still in the hunt. I mean, you know, they could make a move or two and get up there, but you know, they're going to need to score some more points. And the Texans, you can kind of, you know, again, number one race, number one pick. So we'll see what happens there. Jags, Colts play this weekend. They can kind of give one or the two. You know, if the Jags end up winning, it'll really help out, you know, their chances to win the division. And the Colts can kind of bring it a little closer.
Colts might be bringing a new tight end, hopefully. Give you a little bit of a competition and all that.
That's right. That's
but
right.
I mean, the way you're building your team in Jacksonville and all that, it's pretty intense, especially, I mean, you having a weapon of Cordero. I mean, nobody saw that coming whatsoever, and you're reaping the benefits of that. I mean, granted, you ran into the Giants and all that week one, but I mean – you got over that speed bump and you've been plowing through every other team since then. So, I mean, kudos to you.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. Big game there this weekend. So, AFC West. So, this is our boy Josh. Josh is the cellar dweller currently of the AFC West. I think he kind of sees the writing on the wall. I mean, he's been competitive the last couple of years, but I think, you know, he's ready to kind of put on the rebuild hat. I mean, he's on a 5-game loser, you know, only scoring about 168 points a week. But, you know, again, we talked about the Broncos. That was another really bad team last year that Shane's kind of come in and, you know, kind of similar to your story, Al, kind of rebuilt it. Now his, you know, he's had some bad luck. You know, fantasy's all about matchups. I was telling you, I mean, the dude's 1-4 and dropping 220 points a game. But as,
and I'm if you look at it, two like, with 200.
Yeah, and it's look, his points against are 255. So the dude's getting bombs dropped on him every single week. And I think last week he was ready for the dub, and then the Mark Andrews bomb
showed up
Monday night. Yeah. So he's 1-4, but still kind of competitive there. Not a team you want to, you know, run into, because he's scoring just as many points as the second place Chargers, right at 220. The Raiders, I mean, we've talked about them. They, you know, they're pretty good. Got to be probably the favorite for the ship this year, but they've got some injuries, so we'll see how they're able to maintain there. But I believe they're the highest scoring team in the league at 276. So, you know, a hefty 15 points above, you know, my team at least. So
with the Raiders, they won it last year. They're looking to repeat this year. They have a good squad. It was a deep squad. The reason why I use in the past tense now, obviously we talked about the two injuries that they went through and all that. We'll see what they can do next week in week 6 and all that. When we look at this, do our picks and all that, we most likely will be picking the Raiders. But I mean,
there's not many teams, even with those injuries, that are going to hang, right?
Yep, without a doubt. But I mean, this is a tough division to be in, especially when you got a steamroller like the Raiders and all that. So you can just hope to be treading water to stay afloat to hopefully make the playoffs through the wild card and all that. So,
yeah, crazy. Well, before we leave the AFCL, I got to do something real quick.
No problem.
Are you ready?
Yep.
I had to do that.
Too bad I only got one screen. I can't do the Cleveland Rocks.
I don't know how many people in that has scared in this league when they click my team for trade bait, but it scared me a couple times. You know, I forget it and my volume's up. So, all right. So that's kind of your AFC wrap up to date. We'll do the NFC here as well. And then we're going to do our picks. So the NFC North out, very, very, I'd say there's three teams there. The Vikings, you know, have that good young squad, you know, drop it there. You know, they're averaging quite a few points a game at 245, like 30 points above the Bears, who are in second in that division. But the Bears, you know, are also 4-1. So, you know, they're right on their heels, going to have to generate some points. You know, the Bears, that's, you know, Kevin's team, and he traded for Tom Brady, made that big trade for Brady in the offseason. Now Brady's definitely doing, you know, his part, but they're needing to get something on the offensive side from the running backs, the wide receivers. You know, they've got four receivers on the roster, and, you know, really only Mike Davis at running back. So they're going to have to generate some more points if they're going to catch the Vikings, who are, you know, that's a deep Vikings team. Kirk Cousins playing really, really well. He spent all that money on Kirk Cousins in the offseason. Of course, Kamara and DJ Moore is kind of having a, you know, a resurgence there, along with, you know, Cortland Sutton coming off his injury. So Vikings got a good young squad. You know, again, we talked about the Lions on that killer game this week.
Yeah.
Really, really nice game. He's got some young pieces to build around. And then the 0-5. You know, Green Bay Packers, who, you know, are probably going to be looking for that number one pick. I mean, they've got Tua, who's been hurt, so he's going to come back. So he's going to probably score a few more points. I don't think 115 is going to be the norm, but I also don't think he's going to catch, you know, he's not going to double his point total to get to Detroit at 230. So I like this division. You know, I like currently how it stands is personally how I think it's going to finish. You know, you got three really good squads there scoring some points.
I agree. To see another undefeated team, looking at this conference and the other conference, what do we got? I think it's only four undefeated teams and all that.
Yeah, the Vikings, the Raiders, the Ravens, and the Saints.
So, I mean, Bears are clipping at their heels, but well, they haven't played each other yet, have they? The Vikings and the Bears?
No, I don't think so.
So, I mean, they still got to play each other. So, I mean, we'll see what happens. But, I mean, yeah, I agree with you with the Vikings, Bears, Lions.
They play this week.
Oh, they do. Okay.
They play this week. This is another one of those big ones. We talked about the Jags and the Colts. This is a big one here, the Vikings and the Bears.
So, we'll see what happens. We'll see where we pick it and all that in the next section. But, yeah.
Big game to kind of determine, give one or two, you know, give one of them the, you know, either the Vikings the foot up or get the Bears even.
Correct.
All right, so the NFC East, you know, there's those 1-4 Giants that, you know, beat my my Jacksonville Jags here. And, you know, I think they dropped 270 points week one, and they're only averaging 193. So kind of falling off. Dak had that monster game. But, you know, I was talking to Jesse earlier today, and, you know, after week one, he was going to be a buyer here, saying, oh, like I can compete, especially in this division, because honestly, this division is, you know, one of the weaker divisions. And I think it's the division winner in the last couple of years has been very close to 500. It's one of those, you know, very evenly matched. There's not a team head and shoulders above, you know, the others. But he couldn't figure out if he was going to be a buyer. He was going to be a buyer at first. Is on a four-game losing streak, not scoring any, you know, not scoring many points. So we'll have to see, you know, where he ends up. But, you know, he's close to that, if you look for it, 193 points. And the Eagles above him and the Cowboys above him and the Washington Redskins above him have less points per game. So it's all who you score. If you look at his points against, I mean, people are dropping 1,100 points on him. And these other teams have kind of squeaked on. So, you know, once you get in these interdivision games, he may be able to catch up there. But, you know, you've got the Eagles and the Cowboys, 2-3 and 3-2 respectively. And then the Skins we talked about, or the football team, sorry. We can't say the Skins anymore.
You can't say Skins there, John Gruden.
We've got a four-game winning streak. So they're currently winning the division. But I think this is, you know, again, you know, one of those things, one of these divisions, it's going to be very close. They're very evenly matched teams.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, like we said about the win for Washington against the Lions, they could easily be 3-2 right now, and we can have a tie in the Eastern Conference right now, Eastern Division, I mean, whatever. But, I mean, we're in week six. It's going to be tough with I think I was just thinking about it. I think the trade deadline should be coming up also, something for us to look into and discuss maybe next week and all that, because the trade deadline might be coming up soon. But I mean, when is the time to be a buyer? When is the time to be the seller for the Giants? Because yeah, this could be a winnable conference whatsoever.
Oh yeah, 100% for him. This division, he could easily come through. And, you know, again, he's scoring the most points. So when we get in those conference, those inter-division games here, it'll get interesting there. It gets spicy.
Any one of those four can definitely win that division.
Oh, 100%. Yep. All right. So the South, you've got the 5-0 Saints. And then kind of, you know, it kind of falls off here with the Bucs, the Falcons, and the Panthers. I was, again, talking to the Falcons today, and he was saying, you know, hey, I've scored, you know, 240 points a game, and I'm 1-4. Like, how is that even possible? But if you look at it, he's got 1,200, you know, people are dropping bombs on him. I mean, 240 points a game against him, 240 something points a game against him. Mm-hmm. And division with the Saints. I mean, that's tough. But the, you know, this division actually scores some points as well. We talked about one of the other divisions. I think it was the AFC West scoring some points, but I mean, you got the Saints, the number one scoring team in the league, the only team above 300. I mean, they're averaging 303 a game. You know, they're averaging more than my high score. I think I dropped 302 last week. I mean, they're averaging that. You know, the Bucks at 202 a game, Falcons at 240, and then the Panthers at 231. Now, the Panthers, you know, they've, I think, been hit by the injury bug pretty hard. And those guys also, you know, are a lot better than their 1-4 record. You know, shows. I mean, they were without Calvin Ridley last week for personal, but they've got Ridley, Devontae Parker, and Tyler Boyd, and Edmonds, and Henderson, and, you know, the list goes on. Herbert. So that's a lot better team than their record indicates. And that's not a team I want to be playing, especially in that division twice. So those guys with the talent they have could easily, you know, bump up the ladder there. So good division here, one to watch. Again, I don't think anyone's going to catch the Saints, but I think the battle for that second place and then a playoff spot in the NFC, you know, is very possible for either of these three teams.
I agree. Saints are the cream of the crop right there. You can't say anything bad about them. I mean, over 300 points a game averaging. I mean, that's crazy. But I mean, looking at the other teams, that is going to be a dogfight. And I'm being honest to God, I think that's going to be a dogfight for that last playoff. And the sad part is if they, whoever comes out to get that last playoff because of their record, I think they're going to beat a division winner.
Oh, beat one of the other division winners. Yeah.
Winners in the playoffs. I think one of
especially,
these
three, yeah.
One of these three teams, if they go on a hot streak and they can get into that last bid, because I think, like we said, they're going to beat themselves up and all that. And they're going to, one of these guys has got to come out of it. And whoever does come out, they, I think that they're going to win a playoff game in the first round.
Yeah. Agreed. And I think to me, like, I think that's going to be the Panthers. I think they're going to come from a worst to a second place here. So we'll see how that goes. I don't think anyone's catching the Saints, but that'll be something to watch in that division. And then the last division, the NFC West, you know, we mentioned the Seahawks getting their first W of the year. You know, this is another one where points are being scored. Other than the Seahawks are only averaging 184, but you've got, you know, the Niners at 232, the Rams at 242, and then the Cardinals at 255. You know, big move here by the Cardinals. You know, one of their things was, you know, wide receivers and, you know, their offense, getting some depth on that offense. So, you know, their offense pretty much was Josh Allen, but, you know, goes out and gets Baker Mayfield, who obviously is not Josh Allen, but it's a, you know, it's a move to get himself a running back. He now has two running backs in Gainwell and Harris, two young running backs. And then he pairs Robert Woods with Hopkins and Chase and Randall Cobb. So, you know, big move by him. We'll see if that pays off. But, you know, he's kind of one of those teams that, again, 3-2, kind of had some bad luck with who he's run into, you know, including, what, the Saints? That's the game we just talked about, the Saints and Cardinals. You know, the Niners are another one as well. I mean, 3-2 in that division, scoring, you know, close to 235 points. He's gotten some big games from Zeke and then Tannehill, but he's going to need some, you know, some of his offense to step up with, you know, Diggs and Keenan Allen. And then of course, Gallup being injured. So once Gallup gets back, I think he's going to be able to challenge for this division. You know, and the Rams are leading that division at 4-1, kind of, you know, behind the resurgence of Sam Darnold, who's been playing, you know, amazing. And then Eckler is playing amazing. He's got a solid receiving core with that rookie Devonta Smith. You know, he's got Ruggs, who's been playing well. Mike Evans, who's kind of playing well. So, you know, some very good teams in this division. You know, all of them scoring some points, you know, very, very close. The Seahawks, I think, are the, you know, the odd man out here. And I think it's going to be a three-team race for this division.
Without a doubt. And I think it's, we talk about how the South, we already know that the Saints are, looks like the front runner here up there. But I mean, out west, there is no front runner. They're only a game. They're only a game away from each other, and they're just averaging outrageous numbers between 255 to 230. So I mean, that's going to be a good race. Also, I will say those two divisions are definitely going to be fun races to watch, and I'm lucky. That I'm in the AFC, that I don't have to be a part of any of that.
This division, it's funny, it's the NFC West. It kind of reminds me of like the, you know, the Pac-12 games where you're going to get 60 to 58 scores, you know, high scoring, you know, Oregon and USC and Oregon. I mean, these guys all score points, man. It's going to be fun to see these games week in and week out, you know, 260 to 250 and, you know, these high scoring games that people want to watch. So one to watch again, anyone's ball game there. You know, the Cardinals aren't scared to make moves. So we, you know, their team might not even be the same. So you're always wanting to improve, but you know, that'll be a good one to watch. So
without a doubt. That was our breakdown, guys.
Yeah, so that's kind of our AFC and NFC breakdown. And then we're going to kind of move to the last section of our show, where we do our predictions. So, you know, every week it's kind of like college game day almost, where, you know, we pick the next week's games. So our week five, you know, I went 11-5, Josh went 12-4, and Al went 11-5. Now, another thing about the show that we haven't mentioned yet, Al, is we always like to have guests call into the show and kind of, you know, help us break down the games. And then, you know, those of you who have seen the show before, we ask some questions, you kind of get a time to sell your team. And then at the end of the show, just like us, you get to make your picks. So, you know, Laura was on last week, 9-7, and then the commish Blaine, he picked a lot of upsets that didn't come true. So 6-10 was his record. So that was our week five predictions. And then if you calculate them out over the season, you know, I'm still up top, Al, at 59-21, but you look up, you're getting closer there at 55-25. Josh has got some ground to make up, and then guests combine 49-31. So I think
to inform the guys over that don't know our show from the other league and all that, what we did was we just we did our predictions from that
last show,
league and all that, and we brought it over. Now we're bringing over our records and our percentages also, but we will be obviously picking the games here at week six, correct? So
certainly, that was a good little segue, Al.
Yes. So here we go.
Have you done this before, Al?
No, I have not done this before, Ryan. First time caller, first time, long time listener.
Long time listener, first time caller.
Well, yeah.
Anyways, so yeah, we like to have guests on, break it down. I want to extend next week's invitation. You know, he can accept it if he wants, but the New York Giants, who beat me week one, I want to see him on the show next week. So Jesse, if you're listening, let's go ahead and make that happen next week. So Al, moving to the picks section, it's just going to be you and me again. Josh sent, he just wanted to show us that Jordan Cameron jersey.
Yeah, that's it.
Your Jordan Cameron jersey, Al. So Josh actually, you know, he was busy and couldn't make the show, but he sent in his picks. Oh, my gosh. Josh already sent in his picks. So we're not going to, you know, we've got those written down. We'll record them later. But Al and I are going to run through these picks today. So, Al, we got the Ravens and your Cleveland Browns. Who you got?
I'm not going to pull Pete Rose or anything like that, but the Ravens should win this game.
Yeah, I'm going with the Ravens to stay undefeated. The Steelers and the Bengals, this is the Steelers looking for their first win. The Bengals looking for win number two. Who you got?
I got the Bengals on this one.
Bengals for me. Dolphins and Pats, the 4-1 Pats, the 3-2 Dolphins battle for first place in that division.
I've got the, I'll pick the Pats.
Okay. I'm going with the Dolphins. You know, again, never count out a championship GM. So give me the Dolphins.
Hey, just real quick. I just want to mention also, this week is the first week of bye weeks too. So, correct. I mean, granted, we're looking at this. Yeah, check your lineups and all that. I mean, we're making this via what records are and what you've done in the past and all. But, I mean, just make sure because a team could take – we could be picking a winner, but then not realizing that their star player is on a bye and all that. But I just
want to – I can tell you the Falcons are on a bye. So, you know, make sure that your players aren't on bye and that you set your lineups and all those sort of things. So if you got any Falcons players, I know they're on a bye because Patterson's on a bye. Still going.
I know the Jets are too. So
no, Jets are always on a bye or Jets are the bye. Speaking of Jets, we got Jets and the Bills. Who you got, Al?
I'm going with Ant.
You're going with Ant.
I'm going with the Jets.
I'm going with the Bills. I can't go with Jets. can't do it. Jags and sister Colts.
Jags.
I'm going Jags. Titans and Texans. 0-5 versus 2-3 here. AFC South matchup.
Texans. Titans. Sorry. I was reading Titans.
What?
I was reading the board and I'm like, Titans. Gosh,
upset of the year. I'm going Titans as well. Chiefs and Raiders. This could be a bloodbath.
Raiders.
You give me the Raiders too, even with the injuries. So no Wilson, no Barkley. Give me the Raiders. Broncos and Chargers.
I'm going to go Broncos.
I think I'm going to go Broncos too. I think I'm going to pick Shane and the Broncos on the upset. 1-4 Broncos and the 3-2 Chargers. So
they got to win a good one. So I think this could be a good win for them.
I think so too. Something to build on and then maybe make them a buyer here at the break. Vikings and Bears. This is the big one we were talking about in the NFC North. Vikings 5-0, Bears 4-1.
Vikings.
Yeah, I think I'm going to go Vikings here as well. Just a lot for them. You know, a lot of firepower. Packers and Lions. Lions coming off that close game. Packers 0-5. Who you got out?
Lions.
Give me the Lions big. We got an NFC East matchup here. Jesse and the Giants versus the Cowboys. 1-4 Giants, 3-2 Cowboys.
This has got to be the Giants' time to do it. If they don't, they got to be sellers. So I'll go Giants.
This is going to be an interesting one. This will be a very, very close game here. I think I'm going to go with the Giants as well. I know he's hoping for a big game from, you know, that AJ plays and that Dak drops monster like he did in week one. So, you know, we'll see if he's going to be a buyer. We'll see what the records show, but I'm going Giants as well. Eagles and the football team.
Eagles. I'll go football team.
4-1. I'm going with the football team as well. They go 5-1, stay atop of that division. You know, we'll just be a mess. You know, if the Giants win and the Eagles lose. So we'll see what happens there. Saints and Panthers, 5-0 Saints versus the 1-4 Panthers.
The Panthers need – see, we were just talking about the Giants.
Panthers need a win.
The Panthers need a win because we were just talking about how the Panthers could be, like, players in the playoffs and all that, possibly.
Panthers need a win. It's going to be
I'll go Saints.
I think the Saints are going to win, but I think it'll be closer than, you know, what you think. When you see a 5-0 versus a 1-4, you think it's going to be a blowout. It will not be a blowout. It'll be a close game. It wouldn't shock me in the least if the Panthers win.
100% agree.
But I think the Saints win. All right, we got the Bucs and the Falcons. Now, a note on this one, we were talking about byes. The Falcons have Matt Ryan as their quarterback. So he will not have a quarterback here to play. So you got the Bucs playing the Falcons in a divisional game. Falcons have Matt Ryan on a bye. Who you got, Al?
Bucs. And with that, just because of that, right there.
Bucs. Just with that knowledge, I think so too. I think without Matt Ryan, I think the Bucs got to win. Tough for the Falcons, who may become stellars at the break. They dropped to 1-5. Niners and the new look Cardinals. Who you got, Al?
This is going to be a good game.
I agree.
I think this will be. We'll go Cardinals.
You're going.
We'll Cardinals? We'll see what this team, constructed team, looks like. We'll go Cardinals.
New look. I'm going to pick against the committee, and I'm going to go Niners here. I think it'll be a very high-scoring game. I think it'll be close, but I think the Niners eke it out here at the end. Then we got Rams 4-1 versus the 1-4 Seahawks.
Rams.
No doubt. So that's kind of our week 6 schedule. We hope, Al and I hope, that you enjoyed the show that we put on today. It's kind of a different show. You know, we did take a little bit longer than we were planning, but, you know, we wanted to kind of walk you through what to expect from us. You know, we'll have Josh on here next week to go through injuries and then have his commentary. We want to have some of you have interacted on the show before, but we want to have you guys on to kind of, you know, interact. This is the league show. So, you know, it is what, you know, not only what we want to make of it, but what you want to make of it too. So, and if you have any input, any suggestions, let us know. But that's kind of the format we go through. So, you know, with that, we hope that week 6 is fun for everybody, that everybody stays healthy. There's no injuries. Hopefully you can get off this rash of injuries, because it's getting, you know, ridiculous. I don't know if we're going to have people at the end of the year to play. But check your rosters, check your bye weeks. See if you're going to be a buyer or seller here at the end. Update your trade blocks. Al, anything to say to the league before we log off?
No, definitely appreciate bringing the show over. Thank you, Blaine, for having us. Definitely, like you said, we are interactive. We want your input. We want people to be on this. We don't want this is not our show. This is your show also. So that's what it comes down to. This was the league that you brought me into, Ryan. This is, as you said, our first love. So, yeah. I mean,
this is the league that keeps on giving too. So Jesse, the Giants, brought me in. I brought you in. We both kind of brought Jonathan in, the Bengals. And then I brought Shane in as well. So the Broncos. So
like I said, glad to be a part of this, glad to bring this over, look forward to interacting with everybody else. Thanks again.
All right, guys. Week 6. Good luck. Good luck to everybody. We'll see what happens. Stay safe. We'll see you next week on Tuesday, same time, same place.
Talk to you guys later.